In this next set of videos, we're going to walk through various ideas around object-oriented programming and how to technically implement a number of different techniques that are used within Drupal and also used across the board on many object-oriented based projects. So at its core, object-oriented programming will give you a better model of how to organize your code. Now, a lot of PHP programmers started by simply hacking away and trying to get something that's functional. And what you end up with is something called procedural code. You have variables and you have functions, and the role of the functions is to get from point A to point B. It's to complete some kind of task. So for example, we might convert data from one format to another, or we might take some data in an array and organize it according to its alphabetical order. And the idea is that you're constructing your code so that you step through these different procedures. Now, after you have some programming experience, you start to realize that a lot of these functions can be generalized, so you can use them in various other situations. So for example, if you have that function that sorts items in an array alphabetically, you might find that useful to convert other types of data into an alphabetically ordered list, for example, some XML or a set of strings. And as you start to think this way, your mind is actually going more towards object-oriented programming. You're thinking about these functions as these little machines that can be used in different situations, not just the original situation that they were intended for. When you start to dive into tutorials about object-oriented programming, you'll find that people use real-world objects as examples, because in a big way, the world is very object-oriented. The idea is that as you look around you, you see yourself surrounded by these different objects. And objects are basically anything that you can give a noun to. So for example, right now, I'm surrounded by my computer, a glass of water, and a lamp. Because we can name each one of these things, they're really objects. And in the real world, objects aren't limited in the way that they can interact with one another. So for example, I can use the lamp to illuminate the keyboard on my computer. I can use it to see through the glass of water that I have. I can take the glass of water and dump it on the computer. And really, it keeps going. But the idea is that the interaction between the objects in our world are limited more by our imagination rather than any limitation in the object itself. Now, if you apply that idea to your code, then what you should end up with are these components that can be used in ways that were unanticipated at the start, because you have modeled the behavior of that item and contained it in an object. And it turns out that this is actually a pretty natural way for code to be organized. Now, the tricky part at first is taking that idea and seeing how it relates to code. Because most of the time when we're dealing with code, we're dealing with kind of abstract concepts. We're dealing with things that don't have a parallel in the physical world. For example, on a website, we have images, we have forms, we have blocks of content across the page and templates. We can call each of these things by their name, which is a noun, and that indicates, at least on some level, that they're objects. In addition, there are objects that have more abstract ideas associated with them. For example, a calculator that performs some operation on the data that gets sent to it. Or, in the example of our function that sorts alphabetically, we have a sorter. Those little bits of code are like machines, and they're our inventions, and we can give them whatever name we want, but they're objects that didn't really exist before we created them. Now, if you don't immediately see the application of this different way of looking at your code, that is looking at it as objects rather than a set of procedures, that's okay. That sort of perspective comes from actually working with it and seeing how the code is organized and what kind of benefits arise from organizing it in that different way. So just let some of those ideas start to percolate, and we're going to start getting our hands dirty. And along the way, we'll talk about the implications of thinking of your code along these lines.